Let's look at some examples of some common discrete probability distribution problems. I'm going to assume that you've previously been introduced to these distributions, and we're simply going to work through a few examples, although not necessarily in the order given here. For a military mission, engineers are creating an expensive system that relies on an important component. This component is very delicate and fragile, and has a probability of failure of 0.32. That's a very high probability of failure, so to mitigate the risk, they install 6 of these components in such a way that they work independently. And they're connected in parallel, so that if any one of these 6 components works, the system works. What is the probability exactly one of these components works? Let's let the random variable x represent the number of these components that work. We want to find the probability that x takes on the value 1. But what is the distribution of x? Well, here we have a fixed number of components, 6. And the probability that any one of these individual components fails is 0.32. So the probability that any one individual component works is 1 minus that, or 0.68. And it's said here that the components work independently. If that's meant in a probability sense, that knowing whether one component fails or not doesn't change the probability of any other component failing, then all of the conditions of the binomial distribution are satisfied here. We have a fixed number of independent trials, each one with the same probability of success, and we're counting up the number of successes. So here, the random variable x has a binomial distribution with n equal to 6 and p equal to 0.68. Now let's do the calculations. Here's the binomial distribution probability mass function, and we want to know the probability that our random variable x takes on the value 1. And so that's going to be our n of 6, choose 1, times the probability of success, our p, 0.68, raised to the first power, times our probability of failure, 1 minus p, or 1 minus 0.68, raised to the number of failures, which is 6 minus 1. And when rounded to 4 decimal places, this works out to 0.0137. So that's the probability that we'd have exactly one component work. But that's not really a very interesting question in this scenario. Let's look at a more important question. Recall that the system works as long as at least one of the 6 components works. So the most important question is, what is the probability x is at least 1? Because this is the probability that the system works. And that's going to be the sum of the probabilities of 1 through 6. So we could calculate these 6 probabilities using the binomial formula and add them up. But that doesn't sound like too much fun to me, and there's an easier way. The possible values of x are 0 through 6. If we want the probability that x takes on a value from 1 to 6, x bigger than or equal to 1, the only other possibility is x equaling 0. So the probability that x takes on a value that's at least 1 is simply going to be 1 minus the probability that it's 0. And this is equal to 1 minus the binomial probability mass function evaluated at 0. Or in other words, 6 choose 0 times 0.68 raised to the 0 times 1 minus 0.68 raised to the 6th power. And since 6 choose 0 is 1, and 0.68 raised to the 0 is also 1, this simplifies to 1 minus 1 minus 0.68 raised to the 6th power, or in other words, 1 minus the probability that all 6 fail. So we could have taken a bit of a shortcut here and simply answered this using regular probability rules, and not relied on the binomial formula. All of this works out, when rounded to 5 decimal places, to 1 minus 0.00107, and that is simply 0.99893. That is the probability the system will work on this mission. A certain union chapter has 32 male and 26 female members, for 58 members in total. An important committee of 7 people needs to be struck, and the president of the union says they will randomly select 7 of the members to be on the committee. Whether that's a good idea or not is another question, but that's what they're doing here. What is the probability there are exactly 6 women on the committee? Let's let the random variable x represent the number of women selected to be on the committee. we want to find the probability that x takes on the value 6. But what is the distribution of x? It doesn't say here explicitly, but the sampling here is done without replacement. We're simply not going to pick the same person to be on the committee twice. Each person can only be on the committee once, so the sampling must be done without replacement. There are 26 successes in the population, the 26 females, and 32 failures, the 32 men. We are sampling without replacement and counting up the number of successes, so X has the hypergeometric distribution. When answering these probability questions from the hypergeometric distribution, I strongly recommend that we just think it through and don't rely on the formula. It's just easier that way for most people. Here we want the probability that the random variable x takes on the value 6. And the denominator of our hypergeometric formula is going to be the number of possible committees we can choose. And we're picking 7 people from 58, so the denominator is simply going to be 58 choose 7. In the numerator, we need the number of ways of getting exactly 6 women and 1 man. We need to pick 6 women from 26, so we're going to start out with 26 choose 6. And from the 32 men, we have to pick 1, so 32 choose 1. And using a calculator or software, we can find out that that is 0.0245 when rounded to 4 decimal places. How about a slightly different question? What is the probability the committee contains at least 6 women? Here we want the probability the random variable x is greater than or equal to 6, which is the probability it equals 6 plus the probability it equals 7. And we calculate each one of those probabilities using the hypergeometric probability mass function. On the last slide, we worked out the probability that x equals 6. And for the probability x equals 7, it's very similar in spirit. The denominator, once again, is 58 choose 7, but here we need 7 women, so from the 26 women, we must pick 7. And from the 32 men, we have to pick 0, because we're only picking 7 people in total. And when rounded to 4 decimal places, our final answer works out to 0.0267. Suppose a beverage manufacturer, as part of a marketing gimmick, puts tiny gold flakes into a beverage container at a rate of 800 flakes per 1-liter bottle. A 1-liter bottle is randomly selected, shaken vigorously, and a 10-milliliter sample is immediately drawn. What is the probability it contains exactly 2 flakes of gold? Well, let's let the random variable x represent the number of gold flakes in the sample. Here we're counting up the number of occurrences of something in a volume, and that should start our minds thinking about the Poisson distribution. But we also need some other conditions to hold, like these flakes occurring randomly and independently throughout the liquid. Since the container is shaken vigorously, then it's pretty reasonable to think that the flakes are distributed randomly and independently throughout the liquid, at least approximately. So here it's pretty reasonable to think that X will have, approximately, a Poisson distribution. Lambda is the mean number of flakes in the given volume. And here we're sampling a 10 milliliter sample from a 1-liter bottle, which is 1,000 milliliters. So our sample is going to be 1/100th of the liquid in the bottle. And each bottle contains, on average, 800 flakes. So a 10 milliliter sample, on average, is going to contain 8 flakes. The probability mass function for the Poisson distribution, the probability the random variable x takes on the value little x, is equal to lambda raised to the x times e to the minus lambda all over x factorial. Here we want the probability that the random variable x equals 2, that there's 2 flakes in our sample. And that's going to be lambda of 8 raised to the second power times e to the minus lambda, or e to the minus 8, all over 2 factorial. And when rounded to 4 decimal places, that's 0.0107. There's about a 1% chance that we get exactly 2 flakes in that sample. A European roulette wheel has 18 red slots, 18 black slots, and 1 green slot. It's reasonable to assume that the ball is equally likely to land in any one of the 37 slots. And suppose we want to know the probability that the first time the ball lands in a red slot occurs on the 5th spin of the wheel. We'll let the random variable x represent the number of spins needed for the ball to land in a red slot for the first time. And here the big key is that we're interested in the first time it lands in a red slot. And X is going to have the geometric distribution here. The geometric distribution is the distribution of the number of trials needed to get the first success in independent Bernoulli trials, like we have here. For the geometric distribution, if we want the probability the random variable X takes on the value little x, well, we first need x minus 1 failures, so that's got to be 1 minus p raised to the x minus 1, and then on the xth trial we need a success, so that's just going to be multiplied by p. And here, we want the probability that x equals 5. And there are 18 red slots and 37 slots in total, so the probability of success on any individual trial is 18 out of 37. The probability of failure is going to be 1 minus 18 out of 37, and we need to raise that to the fourth power, 5 minus 1. And then we're simply going to multiply that by the probability of success, which is 18 out of 37. And this works out to 0.0338 when rounded to 4 decimal places. How about this one? What is the probability the first time the ball lands in a red slot occurs at some point after the sixth spin? Well, conceptually this is pretty straightforward. If we want the probability X is greater than 6, we add the probabilities of 7 and 8 and 9 off to infinity. But we can't actually add an infinite number of probabilities together without using some sort of mathematical trick. And here we could also say that the probability that x is greater than 6 is going to be 1 minus the probability that x is less than or equal to 6. And we could calculate that without too much difficulty here. But that involves calculating 6 geometric probabilities, the probability that x equals 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 5 and 6, adding that up and subtracting that from 1. So I don't really want to do that either. I'm going to use a helpful bit of logic here. If the first 6 spins are not red, the first red must happen after the 6th spin. So the probability that x takes on a value greater than 6 is equal to the probability that the first 6 spins do not result in red. And so the probability that the random variable x takes on a value bigger than 6 is going to be the probability an individual spin does not result in red, which is 1 minus 18 over 37, raised to the 6th power, so just the probability we get 6 non-reds in a row. And that, to 4 decimal places, is 0.0183. We'd get the same result if we did it this longer way, which involved calculating 6 geometric probabilities. Tom is part of a production process that makes an expensive piece of high-tech equipment. If Tom makes a mistake, the equipment will be destroyed at a high cost to the manufacturer. Tom is good at his job and on average has a probability of 0.001 of destroying an individual piece of equipment. But Tom is a bit shaky psychologically, and if he destroys a piece of equipment, he gets rattled and is more likely to destroy other pieces he works with. What is the probability that Tom destroys exactly 3 of the next 20 items he works on? Here a lot of the conditions of the binomial distribution are satisfied, and you might have thought of that. We have a fixed number of trials, 20, and we're counting up the number of successes, which is him destroying a piece. We have a probability of destroying any individual piece. But here, the number of destroyed pieces would definitely not have a binomial distribution. There's a key line here, in that if he destroys one piece, he is more likely to destroy other pieces. This means the trials are not independent, and independence is a required condition for the binomial distribution to hold, and it's not true here. So the number of destroyed pieces would not have a binomial distribution, or any of the other distributions we've discussed. The situation's simply more complicated than that, and this question is not answerable with the given information. We'd need to know more about the nature of the dependency, and it would be a complicated question. That leads to one final thought. Not every random variable has a nice, simple distribution. One could even argue that in reality, almost all don't. Very often, our probability model is simply an approximation to a more complicated underlying reality.